Good morning, everybody. Welcome to worship at Central United Methodist Church. In case you don't know me, my name is Savannah, and I'm the Director of Discipleship here. If you are worshiping with us online, then we are equally excited to have you with us that way. A few announcements for you. So the first is, you guys probably know this week is Thanksgiving, and so our office will be closed at 1 on Wednesday, and then we'll also be closed Thursday and Friday. So if you need to come by the office or get anything to us, try to get that to us before Wednesday at 1. The second thing is Open Table wanted me to let you know they're so grateful for you helping to kind of clear out some of the extra stuff that we had down there. And they don't have anything to share with us this week, but they will let us know when they have extra things down there again. Last announcement is I am going to be doing an Advent devotional. We're starting Advent soon on the 28th. That's the first Sunday of Advent. So if you would like to receive that, it will be 4 emails, one each Sunday of Advent. And so if you want that, you can tell me after church, or you can text me, call me, email me. Anyway, sign. I just would like to know before Thanksgiving so I can make a kind of like a list to send of who to send that to. So, but if you are interested, I'd love to share that with you. I think that's it for announcements. So let's prepare our hearts and our minds to worship God together today.
Good morning and welcome to worship this day. We thank you for choosing to join us, whether here in person and online today. It is the Sunday before Thanksgiving, and we have much for which we can be thankful and grateful. So let's continue with that. We're going to open with For the Beauty of the Earth, a tune you just heard rendered with our bell choir and Mr. Mooney, Rod Mooney back here, and Katie Duncan with their flute and percussion. But we're going to sing that too. It is a hymn of praise and a hymn of grateful praise. So let's stand as we sing together. And Doug, let's pull the lights up, please, sir.
Let us pray. Lord, today we pray that we would stop trying to find our identity in anything other than being your child and a part of your kingdom. Help us to pay attention in the moments we start placing our identity in something else. Our children, our careers, our marriages, our own gifts and abilities. Help us in those moments to remember that all of those things, even though they are good gifts, will never satisfy us the way that you will. God, help us to believe that we serve you who restores, a God who can take broken people and make them whole, who can take pain and turn it into joy, and who can take death and turn it into life. We all have areas where we need you to bring your restoration, healing, and hope. God, please give us a new sense of purpose. Help us become new people who live out your strength and not our own. Show us how to let go so you can bring purpose out of our pain. As we walk through our lives, we desperately need you. Bring strength out of our pain and use it to help others. God, grant us the grace to see the possibilities for our lives through you. We are often pessimistic about our futures, but you are not. We may always feel like we're going to be stuck in this thing or that, but your thoughts about our futures are good, and they are hopeful. God, our prayer today is that you will restore our identities of who we are in you. We thank you that you are a God of restoration. We thank you that you are a God who has renamed and given us a purpose, given us life through your Son, Jesus, who prayed, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Our next congregation hymn this morning is found in the hymnal. If you wish to grab it, it's page 102 in the red hymnal. Words will be on the screen, of course, and so we invite you, let's stand together as we sing, "Now Thank We All Our God." Children, will invite you down at this point. I believe Mr. Daniel Sprinkle, yes, I see him over there, is coming forward. So any of you who would like to come down and join him, you are most welcome to do so. So please come on now.
Come on down. Price is right. Two people got that joke. Thank you very much. All righty, if y'all brought your stuffed animal, you can hang it onto it in your hand if you want to. If you didn't, don't worry, we brought a few extras. Have y'all ever had any foods that you just did not want to eat?
Tomatoes.
I'm actually with you there. Unless it's mashed up in that bottle that says ketchup, I'm hardly not much for tomatoes. Anybody else? Any food? Yes, ma'am. Broccoli. Oh, I kind of like broccoli, especially if you smother it in Velveeta. Yes, ma'am. Macaroni. Oh, boy. Well, some people, you know, again, it's what you like is what you like. Yes, sir. One more. Okay, so one of mine was Brussels sprouts. Brussels sprouts, to me, that they just looked weird. They looked like little alien eggs or something. But when you cook them with country ham, they're really good. Yeah. Now, back in the old days, there were a lot of rules about what people could and could not eat, especially for Jesus' people, the Hebrews. They could not eat certain animals. They were considered bad and unholy. And so to be offered these foods was strange and different. So I want you guys to do a little thing with me in just a minute. That's why we brought all these stuffed animals. When Peter was praying one day, he was shown in a vision from God a sheet containing all kinds of animals, some of them that were considered clean and you could eat, and others like Brussels sprouts, things that you shouldn't eat or you wouldn't be any good, or broccoli or macaroni or tomatoes. You know, a big old plate of tomatoes just plopped down right in front of Peter, and he'd be like, oh, no, thank you. Not even the fried green ones. But so what we're going to do is we're going to reenact that. So I need, let's see, Miss Lowry, can you be a corner? Mark, can you be a corner? Edmund and Samuel, can you be a corner? Micah, you and Mark can be one. Hang on just a second. Edmund, can you be my microphone stand, Edmund?
Thank you. Hello.
No. Tell whose son he is.
Yellow.
Yes. Stand up. A microphone stand has to stand. No, we are not going to bounce the animals. No, sir.
Mike, get a quarter.
All right. Thank you very much. All right, so Peter, in his vision, he saw a sheet lowered down from heaven with all the animals in it. So if y'all will put your stuffed animals here in the middle, don't flip them, please. There's too many things, and you don't make enough allowance to pay for them. Stand up. If you'll stand, it'll make it a little bit easier. So we had all these animals. Now gently lower it down to the ground. Down to the ground. Well, so very few of them. I don't think the unicorn whale, that may not be real, but they could be. But again, Peter was shown all these animals, most of which he wasn't supposed to eat according to the rules of eating. And he hears a voice to him that says, Peter, eat. And he's like, Father, no. I have never eaten anything wrong in my whole life, not even a tomato. And again, the sheet comes down three times in a row. Once, down, twice. No, don't flip them up. No, sir, it's not the parachute drill. And three times, that's it. And each time he is told, Peter, eat. And he hears, do not call unclean what I have made clean. Now, it sounds kind of weird. Here, you guys may sit down. If you have a stuffed animal in there, recover it. My sons, if you'll recover Dorothy's as well. She was sad she couldn't come see all the stuffed animals. But it was a symbolic vision. Here, you boys can get your stuff off the blanket. Here, hand me the blanket all the way. Thank you very much. It was symbolic in that God was sending Peter to the Gentiles, to people who were not of the Jewish race and so were not included in the Hebrew faith. And he was telling Peter and the church in general that it was good to go out to the people who were not of the faith and spread the faith. That it was no longer restricted to certain people, that everyone, the whole world, could hear the message of Jesus. Which was a very big deal, because otherwise we wouldn't be here in church with me bossing y'all around. So if y'all will bow your heads, please. Father, help us, please, to listen to your word, to know what is right and good, to know what we should do, even if it is uncomfortable to us, even if we feel that we have never done something like that before, even if we are presented with a plate of tomatoes, that we do as you ask us to do and follow you with our heart. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
All right, don't forget your animals. Take them back.
That was wonderful. Thank you for that. I like the visual. Do you guys get the visual of that story? We're going to touch back on that later on. Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Welcome. Welcome to this time of worship here at Central United Methodist Church. My name is David Lee, and I am one of the pastors here. I'm the lead pastor here, and I just want to welcome you into this time of worship. I want you to know that your presence here is a blessing to us, and we hope and pray that this time together can be meaningful, can be a blessing to you, that when you come into this space in this hour, that you are hoping to encounter God and His Spirit in our worship and in our time together. That's my hope and that's my prayer for you in this time of worship. I want to also welcome our online service. Welcome. You are welcome here in this space. Let's take a minute now to pass the peace, to greet one another in a safe way, to let them know that we're happy to see them, and that we're happy to see them. That's it. That's all I was gonna say. Let's pass the peace, shall we? My mind went somewhere, but I didn't. Yeah. Peace be with you. Good to see you. Peace be with you. Good to see you. This was wonderful. This was great. Thank you. And it wasn't just like one or two. You had like other things you were doing. I also wanted to thank our central ringers. This is my first time hearing them, and that was wonderful. And I look forward to, I think you're coming back up, right, later in the service? So thank you. It wasn't just ringing. I don't know if you paid attention. They had other things going on back there. They had to, like, switch stuff, and they had, like, what, I don't know, what those mallets or something? Chimes? Yes. So, wow, that was great. Thank you for that. If you've been with us for a little while, then you know that we've been in the book of Acts. We've been journeying with that early church in the book of Acts, and we've been seeing what's been going on. Who are some of the people that were there? What were some of these incidents that happened? And what does that mean for the church? Because it reveals something about what that church was supposed to be about. And by looking at the church in that early period, we get an idea of what was important for the church. We get an idea of what we ought to learn and what we ought to take away so that it can inform us today of how we can be church. And that's part of the purpose of looking at this book. For us here, it was so that we could see what were the things that were important to that church. What can we take away, and how can we make some of those important things part of our life today so that it could be a part of our witness in sharing God's love and grace and His message for the world. And we are at the last two messages of this series. We're up to chapter 10 and 11, and then beyond that chapter, we get to Paul's missionary journeys. Now, we're not going to talk about that during this series, but I feel like that would be a wonderful series at another time, where we look at Paul's missionary journeys. But for our purposes here in our series, we're just going to look at chapter 10, and then next week we're going to look at chapter 11 to round out our series. This morning in chapter 10, we're going to look at Peter, one of the main disciples that we know about, and a man named Cornelius, who was a Roman centurion. And we're going to find out what this encounter meant for the early church and how that impacted the church moving forward. And so this was a very important event in the life of the church, and we want to take a look at this encounter between Peter and Cornelius. So will you join me in your Bibles, chapter 10 of Acts? We're going to look at verses 1 through 17. Acts chapter 10, beginning on verse 1. In Caesarea, there was a man named Cornelius, a centurion of the Italian cohort, as it was called. He was a devout man who feared God with all his household. He gave alms generously to the people and prayed constantly to God. One afternoon at about 3 o'clock, he had a vision in which he clearly saw an angel of God coming in and saying to him, "Cornelius." He stared at him in terror and said, "What is it, Lord?" He answered, "Your prayers and your alms have ascended as a memorial before God. Now send men to Joppa for a certain Simon, who is called Peter. He is lodging with Simon, a tanner, whose house is by the seaside." When the angel who spoke to him had left, he called two of his slaves and a devout soldier from the ranks of those who served him, and after telling them everything, he sent them to Joppa. About noon the next day, as they were on their journey and approaching the city, Peter went up on the roof to pray. He became hungry and wanted something to eat. And while it was being prepared, he fell into a trance. He saw the heaven opened and something like a large sheet coming down, being lowered to the ground by its four corners. In it were all kinds of four-footed creatures and reptiles and birds of the air. Then he heard a voice saying, "Get up, Peter, kill and eat." But Peter said, "By no means, Lord, for I have never eaten anything that is profane or unclean." The voice said to him again a second time, "What God has made clean, you must not call profane." This happened three times, and the thing was suddenly taken up to heaven. Now, while Peter was greatly puzzled about what to make of the vision that he had seen, suddenly the men sent by Cornelius appeared. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Just a little bit of context. Caesarea was the name of the town, and it was named after Caesar, of course. It was a common practice in those days of the empire. Geographically, though, we are still in Israel, but the town is set up to be a garrison, meaning a military outpost for Caesar and the Roman Empire. So it's Israel, but not really Israel at this time. Something we may not know about the city of Caesarea is that it is very important to the empire. This city was vital in keeping the peace in the Middle East. It was one of the main spots for trading. And so they made, the traders all have to go through Caesarea. And once you do, they were forced to pay a heavy tax. And not only that, it was the main route to get to Egypt. And Rome depended heavily on Egypt for grain. And so, all of this to say, if you are a centurion, right, a Roman officer that is appointed to this town, it meant something. It meant this was an important post, meaning this was an important man, that he was to be respected, that he was capable, he was trustworthy, he was important. So Cornelius had the support of Rome, but we're told in our passage today that he also had the respect and the honor of the Jewish people as well. For he was a man of faith, we're told. He was devout. He was a seeker, not admitted to the Jewish faith, but he lived it through prayers and giving of alms generously. Alms is when you give money to the poor. It's something the Bible tells us to do again and again, to give to the poor. Well, one day, at 3 p.m, we're told that Cornelius has a vision. An angel of the Lord comes to Cornelius in a vision, calling him by name, saying, "Cornelius, your prayers and your alms have ascended as a memorial to God." God listens to our prayers, and God seems to pay attention to how we spend our money. And when it's used in the service of others, when it's used to help the poor, they are like an offering that is raised to God. Cornelius may not have been a Jew, in terms of his race or his religion, but he demonstrated it. He lived it. He lived out what it meant. He honored God through his life. And maybe that's why Cornelius was used in this event to officially usher in the Gentiles to the faith. Cornelius, I want you to send for Simon, who is called Peter. With this command and the ensuing encounter, Peter and the entire church will come to see the gospel as a message that is also for the Gentiles and for the rest of the world as well. The very next day, we're told that Peter goes up on the rooftop to pray around noon. Now, this little detail about prayer and noon is important because noon was one of the times throughout the day that a Jew was supposed to pray. So in the Jewish faith, they didn't say prayer. They said prayers, plural, because you were supposed to pray throughout the day at set times. So it's telling us that Peter was a good Jew, and he was faithful in praying his prayers. That's an important part to the story that I want to return to later. We're told that when he goes up on the rooftop, he became hungry, and he fell into a trance. And in this trance, Peter is given a vision. He sees something like a large sheet come down from heaven. And in it, in the sheet, were all kinds of animals. Some good to eat, some others not so much. He saw four-footed animals, reptiles, birds of the air, and much more. And a voice says to him, "Get up, Peter, kill and eat." Peter, at this command, is horrified. "By no means, Lord. I've never eaten anything that is unclean or profane." And the voice says to him, "What God has made clean, you must not call profane or unclean." And this happens three times in the same way, and then the sheet is taken up to heaven suddenly. For us to grasp what God is up to here, we have to go back to Peter's identity as a Jewish person, his Jewishness. What does it mean to be a Jew? So let me put some of this in context. Israel, for much of its history, was a small race of people, never a superpower, never a player on the world stage, but they believed they were God's chosen people for a purpose. A people of God who were blessed to be a blessing. And when you do that, when that's your calling card into the world, you're going to invite a certain amount of persecution, as we've seen throughout history. But through it all, the Jewish people maintained their identity as Jews, as God's people, and by holding to these strict discipline and regulations. And what were some of these strict disciplines and regulations that they held on to, which held them together as God's people? One was the worship of one God in a world where they believed in many gods. In Deuteronomy chapter 6, it tells us, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord alone. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your might." And what was another feature of the Jewish life? Regular prayers throughout the day. Setting them apart. Setting apart times to devote to God throughout the day. Just as Peter was doing in our passage today. Not only marking out the day, but the week. Keeping the Sabbath holy. Right? The rest of the world works 7 days a week, but Jews will work only 6 days and rest on the seventh, just as God had done in creation. And so this was yet another practice that set them apart from everybody else. What else do we know about the Jewish people that marks them differently? Their diet, right? Their kosher diet was one of those features, characteristics of the Jewish people that sets them apart. They had strict dietary restrictions. To be a Jew meant that you will only eat certain foods prepared a certain way, as their religion dictates. And by doing this, it set them apart from others. And this was a sacred practice for their faith. All of these practices together was a witness to their God and their faith. Because I am a Jew, I will keep to these beliefs and practices. This is what sets me apart from the rest of the world. This identity and these practices are what kept Israel from being swallowed up by the world when they were being passed around like some shiny bauble or some trinket by the superpowers throughout history. So it becomes a slippery slope when you compromise in a detail here and a practice there. And so when this vision comes to Peter, you could understand the crisis that Peter faced by this vision. When God calls him and says, you are to kill and eat these animals. And there were all kinds of animals, clean and unclean, good to eat and not good to eat. And Peter responds, no, by no means, Lord. I can't do that. I've never done that. I have never eaten anything unclean or profane. And here is God telling him to go against his upbringing, his religion, saying to him, what God has made clean, you must not call profane or unclean. Three times, God performs this little drama so that there is no mistake, no room for doubt that this is God and that this is what God desires for him and the world. What God has made clean, you must not call unclean. Though your sins are like scarlet, it says in Isaiah chapter 1, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are as red, they are red as crimson, they shall be like wool. What God has made clean, you must not call unclean. Nothing outside of a person can defile them by going into them. Rather, it is what comes out of a person that defiles them. Mark chapter 7. What God has made clean, you must not call unclean. The foreigner residing among you must be treated as your native born. Love them as yourself, for you were foreigners in Egypt. I am the Lord your God. Leviticus 19. We're talking about eating together, table fellowship, in one sense. Why was that so important? The reasoning seems clear. The people that you sit down with to eat are not strangers, but friends. They are guests at your table. And if you were a Jew at that time, it meant your Jewish family, not anyone outside of that. But God is saying to him, what God has made clean, you must not call unclean. And this was the lesson. This was the message of this vision that God was sharing with Peter. And it seems Peter got that message. When Peter goes to meet with Cornelius, we didn't get to this, but it happens later. When Peter goes to meet Cornelius, who is a Gentile, and all of his Gentile family and friends, the first words that comes out of Peter's mouth were in Acts chapter 10, verse 34. I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. You know the message he has sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. What would it be like for us today to be a church like that? A church that reflects that heart and desire of God. A God who so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. A church that is able to shout from the rooftops that God's love is here, God's love is for all, and that all are welcome in God's family. What would it be like for a church, our church, to be like that? Soon, we will be entering the season of Advent, which leads to Christmas. Imagine your adult child who grew up at home but moved away to a distant city. You know enough about his or her life to know that they hadn't just left home, but that they left the church as well. Not unlike the prodigal son Jesus tells us about. They have known some despair, some difficulty, even some danger. They are far from home, and they're far from church. And you're talking to them on the phone on one evening, and you hear something different in their voice. Mom, Dad, there's a church nearby, and this Sunday, I'm gonna go check out that service. Internally, you are thrilled, right? You're thrilled and overjoyed that your church, that your child now is gonna go back to church. But you temper your optimism and wonder, what kind of church will he or she go to? How will they receive him? How will they receive her? Sunday comes, and your adult child gets up, gets dressed, and finds their way into the doors of the church. Now imagine that church is Central United Methodist Church in Shelby. Here's my question for you. Who is the first person you would hope that they would meet when they pass through those doors and into the church? Huh? Who is that person you would like that child to meet when they come through those doors? What kind of qualities and traits do they possess? What kind of traits and qualities do they possess? Let me name a few. Friendly, warm, compassionate, gracious, loving, hospitable. Studies show that unchurched people are more willing to visit a church for the first time on Christmas Eve than at any other time of the year. This Christmas season, people that have gone away from the church or have never even been to church will be visiting our church. And they will be somebody's son, somebody's daughter, somebody's answered prayer when they walk through those doors. But what kind of church will they find here? What if our church could be full of people just like the ones that you thought of, right? When I asked you, who do you want that person to meet? What if we, our church, could be full of people that were just like that? People that are warm and friendly to the outsider, loving and hospitable to the stranger that comes into our midst. What if we decided that we will be a church like that? What a difference that can make. What an impact we can have, not just here, but in our communities and beyond. So this Advent season that's coming, we still have a little bit of time. So I want you to think about this, and I want you to pray about this. Let's think about the people that God has laid on our hearts, the people that we would like to invite, neighbors, friends, family, because this Christmas or this Advent, we're calling it, come home for Christmas, come home for Christmas. And so first, think about those people, pray for those people, issue the invitation, but also, let's be ready. Let's be ready. Let's expect these visitors and newcomers to come, and let's be ready so that we can greet them with open arms, with open hearts, so that that someone's daughter or that someone's son or that answered prayer will find a loving and hospitable church here at Central. Would you like to be a part of that? Would you want that to be a part of who we are as a church? Yes? Yes? Well, here's how you can do that. I'm glad you said that you'd like to do that. I'm glad you said that you'd like to be a part of a church that is like that, because here's how you can do this. Very simple. Lee Mabry, there she is. She's in charge of evangelism, and she is working to set up two things for this upcoming season. One is coffee and donuts. I heard we used to do this before, but it kind of went away because of COVID, understandable. But we're going to try to bring it back for the season of Advent beginning next week, I think. And we're trying to have it outside because we'd like to have coffee and donuts, and we still don't really allow eating inside. So we're thinking about maybe on that street between 9:30 and 10. Yes, between 9:30 and 10. And so we need people that's going to be able to help us, right? Help us to set up, break down, bring refreshments, make coffee, and just be ready to mingle with people that we meet or the people that come. So that's one. That's one thing that you may think about and say, hey, that's something that I could help with. That's something I'd like to be a part of. The second thing is we need extra greeters. I think Lee has worked on at least two greeters for each Sunday, but we want at least two more, so that we could have more people on hand to greet. And not just to say welcome, but to help them connect to people in our church. And encourage them to fill out a connection card so that we can get some contact information to follow up. So we could have more of a process to say, welcome, we want to get to know you, help us to do that. Does that make sense? Yeah? And so these are very practical ways that I feel that we can all take part in. Coffee and donuts, and this welcome/hospitality group to welcome newcomers that are coming this Advent season. And so if any of these things speak to you, then I want you to stay after service, because we want to have a quick meeting to talk about what some of these things are and to help you sign up for this, because it's coming. It's coming right away. And so we want to make sure we have people in place to do this. So just in the brief moment, just think about that. If that sparks something in you, then I want to ask you to stay behind so we can talk about that. We're asking people to come home for Christmas. This is one last thing. We're asking people to come home for Christmas. This evening, we're going to put out a short, I don't know how it's going to come out. I'm going to put out a short video to issue that invitation for people to come out on Facebook. So if you have Facebook, know that it's going to come through the church, but when it comes through the church, I'd like you to like it and share it. I've never said this in a message before, but I'm saying it now because I don't want this message just to go to our church people. I want this message to go to people that are part of our church. And so if it's only the people that are, because that message will only go to the people that are connected to our church. And so it won't do any good unless you like it and share it. That's what I'm saying. So that's the next thing I want you to do. Okay. All of this is to say, for this season that's coming, let's be a church that reflects that very heart and desire of God, a heart that loves the world so much that he gave his one and only son. And as his people, we ought to be the same way. This Advent, let's be the church that shouts from the rooftops that God's love is here, and this God's love is for all, and that I want you to know that you are welcome here in God's family at Central United Methodist Church. Let us be a church that reflects the heart of God in our life together and in our community at large. This is what I pray for you and for us as we move in to this glad season of Advent. Will you pray with me? Loving and gracious God, we are grateful for the ways that you show your love for us, that you are present with us, you care for us. But you desire that love does not remain with us, but that we reflect that love to all those around us. Father God, as we look to this upcoming season, help us to be servants, help us to be conduits, help us to be messengers of your grace and of your love. Help us to be the kind of church that can reflect that same love to everyone around us. Help us to take a part. Help us to step up in some way, serve in some way to help somebody feel welcome, to help somebody feel like they are seen, help somebody feel like that they are cared for. And so we pray as we move into this season for your spirit to move in us, that we may go forward as your people on earth, to be as light, to be as salt, to be as love and grace for those that you place in our lives. May this be our hope. May this be our church come this Advent season. We love you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us move into a time of offering at this time. We will not be passing the plates, but know that there are offering boxes available at the exits. Please give as you are led. Let us be grateful for the ways that God has continued to bless us, continue to provide for us, continue to be present with us, even through difficult times. And so as Libby will play a song for us, let us be mindful of the ways that God has blessed so that we may be a blessing, so that through the gifts that he has given to us, that we may give back to the life of this church so that it may serve the mission of him, of the mission of God and the world. Libby. As we offer our treasure and hearts to you, O God, may they be used to pass on the promise of hope, of peace, of life, of community to all in need, of your gifts and presence in their lives. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Thanks. Hey, I want you to have a wonderful Thanksgiving this week. Yeah? I want you to eat as much turkey or stuffing or do whatever it is you love to do on Thanksgiving, spending time with family and friends. I want you to have a wonderful Thanksgiving. I want that for you. Yeah? And then I want you to think about what are the ways that we can give thanks to God for the ways that He has been so good to us, right? What are the ways that we can give thanks back to God? How are the ways can we look at this upcoming season and see ourselves to help and to serve in some way? So that's what I hope for you. Have a wonderful Thanksgiving, and at the same time, I want you to think about the ways that you can give thanks, the ways that you can give back to God through the life of this church and in the community around us. Go in peace. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God the Father, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forever. Amen.
I know at this point,
just do that one.
Thank you. You may have a seat. I know at this point you're usually thinking about which door you're going to leave.
We're not done.
So, you still can. We're not going to hold you here very long. But you have two things that you can be kind of meditating on today. Opportunities, of course, that David has laid forth for us to think about and hang out and see how you maybe can plug into that. Two, our bell choir has prepared a really kind of rocking fun thing to share as we go out today. So I invite you, normally you leave for the postlude, and you certainly can do that. This is a, a free country and a free church. The doors are still there. Nobody's locked. So go do what you need to do. But you're going to miss something really joyful and fun if you do. I'll just unashamedly tell you that. So I hope that you'll stay as we offer the postlude following the chiming of the Trinity.